Good morning, good morning, good morning. For truly this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in him. Glory to God. I am Prophetess Shareta Berry, and I'm going to welcome you on this morning. Today is the Sabbath day, and on today we will be studying out of the book Pigs in a Parlor, The Practical Guide to Deliverance by Frank and Ida Mae Hammett. Glory to God. We will also be have the study guide as well. So we'll be studying together, glory to God, so that we can be well-versed in deliverance and know how to do deliverance and know the different aspects of deliverance and what we need to do to help get people delivered from all manners of evilness, demons, disease, demons and imps, spiritual wickedness in high place, demonic activity, prince of Persia, principalities, rules of darkness. Glory to God. So for those of y'all that may have the book, you may want to pick it up. For those of y'all that do not have the book, we did put Amazon.com where you can go and order a copy of Pigs in a Parlor, Practical Guide to Deliverance, the book, as well as the study book as well. And the study book is called the same thing, Pigs in a Parlor Study Guide, Glory to God, by Frank and Ida Mae Hammett. Glory to God. So we'll be doing both. We'll be going giving you questions as well. And also on today, we will be starting with chapter 1, glory to God. And we will be reading it, glory to God, until we finish. We're going to do a chapter a day until we finish the whole entire book. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So have your Bibles out, ready to take notes. Glory to God. And as we read, as we go into the study guide, give you the questions, and then we're going to give you the answer to the questions as well, so that you can have them for yourself, so that you can share them with those in your ministry, with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Glory to God. Let us go into prayer. God, I thank you for waking us up this morning. I thank you for allowing us to see a brand new day in you, Lord God. I thank you for this time. I thank you for this hour. I thank you for this minute. I thank you for the second, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. God, I cancel every curse, hex, vex, and spell, every spiritual wickedness in high places, demonic activity, prince of Persia, principalities, prince of darkness, rules of darkness, every demon, every imp, every spirit, in the name of Jesus. I cancel spirit of backlash, retaliation, and vindication in the name of Jesus. I cancel every spirit of deceit and deception, spirit of torment, torture, manipulation in the name of Jesus. Every spirit that comes to hinder in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I cancel every dark that's coming from the north, south, east, and west in the name of Jesus. The north, west, the south, east, that the enemy has sent forth in the atmosphere this morning to come against the people of God. I cancel every spirit of sickness, infirmity, and disease that has attached itself to the body of Christ in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And I call forth the fire from heaven to light up anything that is unclean, ungodly, unholy, that is an abomination to God's eyesight, ear, gaze, and nostrils. In the name of Jesus, I call forth the angelic angels to stand God in the four corners of the earthly realm to do battle on our behalf, to measure our territory, to serve, to protect, and to cover us in this season. In the name of Jesus, God, I thank you for signs, miracles, and wonders. Lord God, I thank you, Lord God, for the blessings on today, God, that we will receive, Lord God, so that you can get the glory, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, God, we pray for those that are in mourning on this morning. In the name of Jesus, those that lost their loved one on this morning. In the name of Jesus, God, I thank you. God, I praise your name, God. We give you glory. We give you honor with glory and honor is due. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, let's worship him on this morning. Come on, let's praise him on this morning. Hallelujah. We give him glory. Hallelujah. We give him glory. We give him glory. We give him glory. We give him glory. Hallelujah. As we seal this prayer with the precious brother Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, we say amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So we're starting with chapter 1. We're going to be reading the chapter first, Out of Pigs in a Parlor, The Practical Guide to Deliverance. And then we're going to go to the study guide because we have some questions that they had proposed to us, glory to God. So I hope you have your Bibles, as we will be reading the Bible scriptures also in the name of Jesus. Chapter 1, Pigs in a Parlor. Demon spirits can invade and indwell human bodies. It is their objective to do so. By indwelling a person, they obtain a greater advantage in controlling that person than when they are working from the outside. When demons indwell a person, he or she is said to have evil spirits, to be with evil spirits, or to be possessed with demons. Let us go over to Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 17. We have a lot of scripture, glory to God, that we're going to read on this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mark, glory to God, the 9th chapter, glory to God, verses 17. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mark, the 9th chapter, verse 17. Glory to God. And I'm going to read it from the New King James Version. Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit." That's Mark, the 9th chapter, verse 17. Now let's go over to Luke, the 4th chapter. Luke, the 4th chapter, verse number 33. Glory to God. Luke, the 4th chapter, verses number 33. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 33, from the King James Version Bible. And in the synagogue there was a man which had a spirit of the unclean devil, and cried out with a loud voice. The next chapter is Mark, the 1st chapter, verses 23. Mark, the 1st chapter, verse 23. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And I'm coming from the King James Version Bible. Hallelujah. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out. The next chapter is Mark 5:2. Mark, and I'm going to give you these scriptures again. Mark, the 5th chapter, verses 2. From the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. The next one is Matthew's, the 4th chapter, verses 24. Matthew's, the 4th chapter, verses 24, and I'm still coming from the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. Glory to God. We read Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 17, Luke, the 4th chapter, verses 33, Mark, the 1st chapter, verses 23, Mark, the 5th chapter, verses 2, Matthew, the 4th chapter, verses 24. The word translated possessed by the King James Version is the Greek word demonizio. Many Greek authorities say this is not an accurate translation. It should be translated demonized or have demons. Much misunderstanding has resulted from the use of the word possessed. This word suggests total ownership. In this sense, a Christian could never be demon possessed. He could not be owned by demons, but is owned by Christ. Over in 1 Peter, 1st chapter, verses 18 and 19. Let us go to 1st Peter. Glory to God. And we're going to give these scriptures, glory to God, at the end, at when we finish this chapter. Glory to God. 1 Peter, the first chapter, verses 18 to 19. And I'm still coming from the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. For so as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by tradition from your fathers, but the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. That was 1 Peter, the first chapter, verses 18 to 19. Go over with me to 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter. That's 1 Corinthians, glory to God, the 6th chapter, verses 19 to 20, still from the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. What know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God. Glory to God. The Christian should always consider indwelling demons as unnecessary and undesirable trespassers. A trespasser is one who unlawfully and stealthily encroaches upon the territory of another. Trespassers can continue their unlawful practice until they are confronted and challenged on the basis of one's legal rights. Jesus has purchased the believer, glory to God, with his own blood and has made him a steward over his own life. The devil has no legal right to him. However, it is up to him to defend his rights. No demon can remain when the Christian seriously desires him to go. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. James, the 4th chapter, verses 7. Demons consider the body of the person indwelt to be their house. Turn over with me to Matthew, the 12th chapter, verses 43 to 44. Glory to God. Matthew, the 12th chapter, verses 43 to 44. Still in the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. Then he said, I will return into my house from whence I come out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. That was Matthew, the 12th chapter, verses 43 to 44. It is not uncommon for demons to speak through a person who is being delivered. Go with me to Mark, the 1st chapter. Mark, the 1st chapter, verses 23 to 24. Glory to God. Mark, the 1st chapter, verse 23 to 24. And there was in their synagogue a man with unclean spirits, and he cried out, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God. That was Mark, the 1st chapter, verse 23 to 24. I have often heard evil spirits declare, this is my house. They are referring to the person's body and are seeking to deceive the person and the deliverance minister into thinking that they have a right to that body. No demon can back up such a claim. All demons are liars and deceivers. These have no title to bodies redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. When demons are being commanded out of a person, they will sometimes contend, "I have been here a long time," as though tenure of occupancy gives them title to the person's body. The Christian must be assured that no demon has a legal right to indwell his body. 25 times in the New Testament, demons are called unclean spirits. The word unclean is the same word to designate certain creatures which the Israelites were not to eat. Let's go over to Acts the 10th chapter. Glory to God. Acts the 10th chapter, verses 11 to 14. I'm still in the King James Version Bible. Glory to God. But Acts the 10th chapter, verses 11 to 14. "And saw heaven open, and a certain vessel descending upon him, as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners, and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, 'Rise, Peter, kill and eat.' But Peter said, 'Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean.'" That was Acts the 10th chapter, verse 11 to 14. The pig was one of these unclean creatures, according to the Old Testament law. They were not to be eaten or even touched. The New Testament lists this prohibition by showing that these creatures were spiritual types. Go with me to Colossians, the second chapter. Verses 15 to 17. Glory to God. Still in the King James Version Bible. Colossians, the second chapter, verses 15 to 17. "And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a shew of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ." Glory to God. Hallelujah. So over here in the book that we're the pigs in a parlor, it shows God disarmed the principalities and powers that were arranged against us, and made a bond display and public example of them, and triumphing over them in him and in it, the cross. "Therefore, let no one sit in judgment on you in matters of food and drink, or with regard to the feast day, or a new moon, or a Sabbath. Such things are only the shadow of things that are to come, and they have only a symbolic value, but the reality, the substance, the solid fact of what is foreshadowed, the body of it, belongs to Christ. As a spiritual type, the pig is to the natural realm what the demon spirit is to the spiritual realm. Just as the Israelites zealously protected himself from contact with pigs, the Christian is to guard himself from contact with evil spirits. What would you do if a herd of filthy pigs come into your parlor and begin to make themselves at home? Would you invite such a thing? Would you pay no attention to them in the hope they would soon leave of their own accord? Would you try to clean up their mess as fast as they made it? You would do none of these things. You will drive them out as quickly and uncleanly as possible. And this is to be our attitude toward demon spirits. As soon as they are discovered, they are to be driven out. All four Gospels recorded the event of Jesus cleansing the temple. This is an unusual picture of our Lord. He was filled with righteousness, indignation at what he found in the temple. It was no time for mere words. It was a time for action. He began personally and determinedly to purge the temple of every defiling thing. This is an illustration of the cleansing of our bodies, which are temples of the Holy Spirit, from all that is unclean. Demon spirits provide nothing good. They only defile. They have no place in us than the cattle, birds, and money changers had in earthly temples. We can act in the same authority with which Jesus cleansed the temple and rid ourselves of the fallen evil spirits. Jesus did not make pretty speeches or debate with those who defiled the temple. He drove them out. And unreasonable as it may seem, some Christians are not as ready to get rid of indwelling demons as one might assume. Some are embarrassed to admit the need for deliverance. The embarrassment should never result from having them, but in failure to act promptly in getting them out. Others have walked in agreement with certain spirits for so long that they do not want to change. Not all Christians really want to live in purity. Such are those who have made friends with pigs. But even the prodigal son came to himself while among the swine and decided that he would separate himself and return to his father. Let us pray that all of God's children who come back with spiritual swine will see that there is a better life. Glory to God. A research scientist in a biochemistry told me of an experiment in which he was engaged. It was his objective to isolate and identify the factors which are reasonable for hog pig odors. By determining the reason why hogs smell as they do, it would then be possible to find an antidote. Thus, hogs could be made more compatible with human society. It is not our objective to make demon spirits compatible. We are not looking for ways to make demons easier to live with, but how to get rid of them. We do not want pigs in our parlors. And that was one, chapter one. Glory to God. Let us go. Let me give the scriptures before we go to the study guide. Glory to God. The scriptures that we read, glory to God, on today came from Mark the 9th chapter verse 17, Luke the 4th chapter verse 33, Mark the 1st chapter verse 23, Mark the 5th chapter verse 2, Matthew's the 4th chapter verses 24, 1 Peter the 1st chapter verse 18 to 19, 1 Corinthians the 6th chapter verses 19 to 20, glory to God, Matthew's the 12th chapter verses 43 to 44. Okay, then we got one more scripture we're going to read. Then we read Colossians the 2nd chapter verses 15 to 17. And another, then we read resist the devil and he will flee from you. James the 4th chapter verses 7. Glory to God. Now let us go over to the study guide. Glory to God. So now we're on the study guide, resist the devil and he will flee from you, James the 4th chapter verses 7 from the King James Version Bible. The Christian should always consider indwelling demons as trespassers, one who unlawfully encroaches upon the territory of another. They are to be confronted on the basis of one's legal rights. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit, purchased and redeemed by Jesus, work on the cross. Thus the Christian should be assured that no demon has a legal right to indwell his body,
A demon cannot remain when the Christian seriously desire him to go. What would you do if you, as we read, we just doing a recap from reading the book. What would you do if a herd of filthy pigs came into your home? Would you pay no attention to them in the hope they would soon leave? Or of their own accord, would you try to clean up their mess as fast as they made it? Would you do none of these things. You would drive them out as quickly and certainly as possible. And this is to be our attitude toward demons. As soon as they are discovered, they are to be driven out. Now, questions for review. We're going to give these questions for review, and we're going to give you enough time to answer them. Glory to God. And then we want to go over the answers. Glory to God. In the name of Jesus. So you may want to get your pencil and paper. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. The first question. And you can ask, and we're going to give you time enough to answer, and then we're going to go move on to the next questions, and then we're going to do the answers. Question for review. The first question, what does the title of this book suggest to you? What does this title of the book of this book suggest to you? The title of the book is Pigs in a Parlor, Practical Guide to Deliverance. Some of y'all may wanna write the questions down and then go back and play the podcast over again and then answer the questions as I was reading. Question two. What is the goal of demon spirits and why? What is the goal of demon spirits and why? Question three, what makes someone or something spiritually unclean? What makes someone or something spiritually unclean? Once again, question one was, what does the title of this book suggest to you? Number two, what is the goal of demon spirits and why? Number three, what makes someone or something spiritually unclean? Question 4. Consider possession of land versus trespassing. What is the key difference? Consider possession of land versus trespassing. What is the key difference? So they were the four review questions. Now you want to draw a line, and then you have biblical foundation questions. We have biblical foundation questions. Number 5. In Luke the 4th chapter verses 33-34, a man with an unclean demon cries out before Jesus. What does he tell Jesus to do? In Luke the 4th chapter verses 33-34, a man with an unclean demon cries out before Jesus. What does he tell Jesus to do? Number 6. Read Matthew the 8th chapter verses 28-29. Where violent demons speak out in fear. Of what were the demons afraid in the above passage? Read Matthew the 8th chapter verse 28-29, where violent demons speak out in fear. Of what were the demons afraid in the above passage? That was A. B. Why is this ironic? So 6 has two parts, A and B. Read Matthew the 8th chapter verse 28-29. Where violent demons speak out in fear. A. Of what were the demons afraid in the above passage? B. B, why is this ironic? Number 7. In Mark the 9th chapter verses 17 to 18, what kind of demonic activity was occurring? Who was its victim? Number 7. In Mark the 9th chapter verses 17 to 18, what kind of demonic activity was occurring? Who was its victim? Number 8. Is there a relationship between deliverance from demon activity and the healing of physical bodies? Is there a relationship between deliverance from demon activity and the healing of physical bodies? You want to read Luke the 4th chapter verses 38 to 39, and you also want to read Luke the 13th chapter verses 11. Luke the 4th chapter verses 38 to 39 and Luke the 13th chapter verse 11. Number 8. Is there a relationship between deliverance from demon activity and the healing of physical bodies? Glory to God. And if you miss any question, remember at the end of the broadcast, you can always go back and re-listen and write and catch the question. Glory to God. Number 9. Matthew's the 12th chapter verses 43 to 44 has two parts. Number 9 question. Read Matthew's the 12th chapter verses 43 to 44. A. If demons are trespassers, how could they call your body their house? A. If demons are trespassers, how could they call your body their house? B. What character traits do these demons show by claiming your body as their house? B. What character traits does these demons show by claiming your body as their house? C. In the above verse, we are told that a demon finds no rest until he can reclaim a body to inhabit. What parallel to this exists in nature? In the above verse, this is C, we are told that a demon finds no rest until he can reclaim a body to inhabit. What parallel to this exists in nature? 10. Read the account of the guardians demonic. Read the account of the guardians demonic. Read Luke the 8th chapter verses 26 to 33. A. Could the man speak for himself? B. Who spoke? C. What did the man do to receive his deliverance? D. What does this say to you concerning the assumption that there are those who are unable to be helped? Once again, verse number 10. Read the account of the guardians demonic. Read Luke, the 8th chapter, verses 26 to 33. A. Could the man speak for himself? B. Who spoke? C. What did the man do to receive his deliverance? D. What does this say to you concerning the assumption that there are those who are unable to be helped? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to take a short break. And we're going to come back after this praise and worship.
Good plans.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We apologize for that. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We having some technical difficulties because we're trying to take a break. Just got to take a water break for a minute. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Trying to play the praise and worship song. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But nevertheless, glory to God. Because we, you know, got to wet the throat a little bit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus, we thank you. We praise your name. Hallelujah. We give you glory. We give you honor. For glory and honor, hallelujah, is due unto you, God. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We determined we're gonna get you some praise and worship music. You know, so you can get up and move around a little bit and take a bathroom break if you have to. Glory to God. And in the name of Jesus, and stretch your limbs. Glory to God. Because it's, we know, we understand that there's a lot to take in. Hallelujah. But nevertheless, we need to know about deliverance. Glory to God. We need to know about deliverance. Hallelujah. Deliverance. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We praise your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, we lift your name up on high. Hallelujah. We lift your name up on high. Glory to God. We lift your name up on high. Come on, let's worship him. We lift your name up on high. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We lift your name up on high. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're going to come back. We're going to come back to what we're doing. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's worship him. Come on, let's praise him. Come on. We're going to listen, since we couldn't get that worship music to play, we're going to listen to Lifeline. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Courtesy of Life Church, glory to God, which is a worship song.
When I'm drowning, oceans raging all around me, through the thunder and the waves, you're constant, you're my lifeline in the storm. Never leave me. It doesn't matter what I'm facing. No. And when I'm failing, you're holding on to me. And I'm holding on to you. Me.
To God, hallelujah. That was Lifeline, glory to God, hallelujah. Song, courtesy of Fresh Life Worship, glory to God. Glory to God, hallelujah. Courtesy of Life Church, glory to God. Awesome song. I love that song, really do. I love that song. Now, for those of you on this journey, we're doing a study and from the book Pigs in a Parlor, Practice of God to Deliverance, by Frank and Ida Mae Hammett, glory to God. We just got finished reading chapter 1 in the book. Now we're in the study guide. Glory to God, Pigs in a Parlor study guide. Glory to God. And we stopped at number 10 because we're on the biblical foundation questions. So those of you all that just joined us, glory to God, you can go back in after the broadcast is over and re-listen in, glory to God. So we stopped at number 10. So number 11, pigs and their herdsmen were biblically unclean. Pigs and their herdsmen were biblically unclean. A. What does the fact that the legion of demons was willing to enter the pigs tell us about the demonic activity? B. Given the demise of the pigs, what does this tell you about demons' spiritual knowledge? 11. Pigs are the end they herdsmen were biblically unclean. A. What does the fact that the legion of demons was willing to enter the pigs tell us about demonic activity? B. Given the demise of the pigs, what does this tell you about demon spiritual knowledge? Glory to God. 12. In Mark the 9th chapter verse 26, how did the demon leave the boy? In Mark the 9th chapter verse 26, how did the demon leave the boy? Number 13, give your answer to 12. Number 12, why do you think Jesus agreed to allow the demons to enter the pig? Give your answer to number 12. We just read Mark the 9th chapter verse 26. How did the demons leave the boy? Why do you think Jesus agreed to allow the legion of demons to enter the pig? Number 14, you want to read Luke the 11th chapter verse 20. We have so far seen Jesus ministering deliverance in the number of instances. Was the casting out of demons a critical part of Jesus' earthly ministry? You want to read Luke 11 chapter verse 20. We have so far seen Jesus ministering deliverance in a number of instances. Was the casting out demons a critical part of Jesus' earthly ministry? Number 15. Read the Lord's Prayer in Matthew the 6th chapter verse 9 to 13. Read the Lord's Prayer in Matthew the 6th chapter verses 9 to 13. How critical was the ministry of deliverance to God the Father? How critical, glory to God, was the ministry of deliverance to God the Father? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. How critical was the ministry of deliverance to God the Father? That's number 15. Number 16. Read Luke the 4th chapter verses 15 to 14. Read Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 15 to 19. I'm sorry, verses 15 to 19. Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 15 to 19. It turns out that an immeasurable part of Jesus' earthly ministry involved delivering individuals from even evil spirits. What does this say to the church and her pastor's shepherd? Number 16. Read Luke the 4th chapter verses 15 and 19. It turns out that a measurable part of Jesus' earthly ministry involved delivering individuals from evil spirits. What does this say to the church and her pastor's shepherd? Number 17. Glory to God. Some groups decide not to address the need for deliverance within their congregation. Do you think that believers will be helped in their search for freedom if the pulpits ignore this topic? Number 17. Some groups decide not to address the need for deliverance within their congregation. Do you think that believers will be helped in their search for freedom if the pulpits ignore this topic? Number 18. How else can this information reach the people? How else can this information reach the people? Now, these last three questions is for personal reflection. Personal reflection. There was a group of questions. Questions 1 through 4 was questions for review. Glory to God. Questions 5 through 18 was biblical foundation questions. Now we have questions 19 to 21 for personal reflection. So number 19, do you suppose has transpired, what do you suppose has transpired in an individual's life by the time he or she seeks deliverance? Number 19, what do you suppose has transpired in an individual's life by the time he or she seeks deliverance? Number 20, what does Hosea 4, the 4th chapter, verse 6 tell you? What does Hosea, the 4th chapter, verse 6 tell you? Number 21, what does the following passage from the King James Version tell you about those who seek deliverance with honesty and sincere? Joel, the 2nd chapter, verse 32 from the King James Version Bible. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Joel, the 2nd chapter, verse 32. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Number 21, what does the following passage from the King James Version tell you about those who seek deliverance with honesty and sincerity? And we read Joel the 2nd chapter verse 32. Yes, from the King James Version Bible.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. www.impactchristianbooks.com/WILES. That's www.impactchristianbooks.com/WILES.
Now we're going to go to the answers. Glory to God. So we're going to give the answers to all 21 questions. Glory to God. And we know some of y'all may have answered the questions while I gave them. And some of y'all may go back from the beginning, from when we read the book, and then answer the questions accordingly that way. So number 1, our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, houses. It is wrong that unclean spirits, demons, be allowed in. So this is the answer to chapter 1 questions that we gave. I just got finished giving you. Number 2, demon spirits aim to indwell human bodies. In doing so, they can more powerfully influence that person than when they work from the outside. Number three, exposure to or participating in sin or unhealthy conditions, whether physically and mentally, also sin within the bloodline. Number four, possession suggests total ownership, whereas trespassing denotes an unlawful occupant. Number five, go away or let us alone. Number six, remember these are the questions to the answers to chapter one questions that I just got finished giving you. Number six, A, torment and destruction before the proper time, that they will be tormented in the abyss. B, this is ironic because the tormentors themselves will be tormented. Seven, muteness and epileptic convulsions or seizures. The victim was a young boy. Number eight, there is such a thing as sickness being caused by a demonic spirit. Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 38-39, Jesus rebuked a fever. Luke 13:11, a spirit of infirmity was the root cause. Number nine, demons claim that your body is a house. A, demons make this claim through lies and deception. Satan is referred to as the father of lies in John 8 chapter verses 44. B, they show the desire to control and possess a living body and to deceive the victim into believing that the demonic behaviors and thoughts are part of the person. C, parasites such as ticks and leeches must attach themselves to another living being in order to thrive. Number 10, A, no. B, the demon leader of the legion within the man, which was comprised of 2,000 demons. C, he fell at Jesus' feet in supplication. D, if Jesus delivered the most extreme case, then all things are possible. Number 11, demons can enter animals as well as humans. B, demons are spirit beings, do not have all knowledge. 12, the boy fell into tremble, convulsions, and appeared as dead. 13, he knew that losing 2,000 demons at once could be extremely stressful for the man. 14, if Jesus cast out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon us. Casting out demons is the basis for the establishment of the kingdom on earth. As light advances, darkness flees, and individuals are then set free from demonic oppression and torment. 15, deliver us from evil is part of Jesus' model prayer to the Father. 16, God's people, especially his leaders, should function in the same way that Jesus, our great shepherd, did. Number 17, no. 18, deliverance turns meeting independently, and books and audio teachings on deliverance can help those who would not otherwise be aware of the topic. 19, often the individual is at the point of desperation because all else has failed. 20, God's people perish for the lack of knowledge. And 21, all who submit to Jesus, call on the Lord, can be delivered. And we just gave you the answers to all 21 questions that we went over. Glory to God. So this puts an end to chapter 1. Glory to God, as we talk about chapter 1 is pigs in the parlor. Glory to God. On tomorrow, chapter 2, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Chapter 2 is our spiritual enemies. Our spiritual enemies. Glory to God. Remember, bring paper, pen, and your Bible. We have some questions of review. We have the biblical foundations questions. And we also have personal reflection questions. Glory to God. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So, now tomorrow we're talking about our spiritual enemies. That is chapter 2. And like I said, we will go through the whole entire book, glory to God, until we are well versed in deliverance, glory to God, and how to do deliverance service.